we live? Oh, good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody who's here. It's lovely that you could join us. Thank you for, sorry we're starting a little bit late this morning, but yeah, it's really lovely to welcome everybody. If you're online, if you're in Zoom or if you're in Facebook, I encourage you to say hi to each other, send a message in the chat just to let each other know that you're there. I really encourage you. If you're here, I encourage you to, you know, wave at each other. The good thing is that you're here, so you get a chance to hang out and chat with each other after the service as well, very briefly and socially distanced. Thank you. We have some announcements to make this morning. Welcome to Communion Sunday. This is the day where it's a day of celebration and remembrance. And if you haven't got it already, I encourage you, if you're here in Lucan joining us, a bit too late, but we'll sort something out for you. Let us know if you're missing stuff. Let the ushers know. If you're at home and you haven't yet prepared your communion, can I please encourage you to go and do that ASAP and come already. But today's a lovely chance where we get to share communion together. We have care groups. Last week was the first week of this new season of care groups. There are lots of them. If you're not part of one already, one of the things that God is doing in this church family is teaching us to welcome one another and to treat each other like family. So come and help us learn how to be family to one another, and please join one of the groups that we have. Get in touch online, get in touch with someone that you know in this church community, and we'll link you in somewhere. And that's really it for this morning, other than you're welcome, we're delighted to be together, and yeah, we're just going to enter into a time of praise and worship.
I don't think Sam has ever been so short in his life. What has happened? Yeah, you're so incredibly welcome this morning. It's clearly a time of personal growth. If you guys want to stand, we're just gonna enter into a time of worshiping God together. The first song we're gonna do this morning is a song you may not have heard, you probably haven't heard. It's called "Only a Holy God." And yeah, I think just the second I heard this song, it's just the lyrics are beautiful and it really honors God. And I don't think you need to be anything. Do you know what I mean? Like the simplest creatures can sing this song, because it's just the truth about who God is. And it's just about him being mighty and wonderful and a holy and a perfect God. So if you know it, sing along. Hopefully you'll catch on to the lyrics. If you don't know it, I just encourage you, read the lyrics, take this time to pray. We just wanna worship God. Father God, it is so good to get to come before you. A holy and a wonderful God, Lord, who takes us as we are. Father, will you just be in our midst this morning? Will you honor us by your very spirit, Lord, that created the heavens and the earth, being here amongst us, God? What an honor that is. Lord, will you be blessed? Will you take our acts of worship, Lord, and may they be pleasing and favorable in your sight? Lord, will you lift up your eyes towards us this morning as we just come and worship you? Thank you.
just as we're singing some praises to God and lifting his name up, just brought some scripture to my mind, and it's in the Gospel of John. It says, my command is this: love each other as I have loved you. And greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And just reflecting over that as we sang that last song, we take this whole idea of Jesus as our friend, God as our friend, as something we've received it well, and it's allowed us to meet with God and not be scared. But just reflecting on it, the King of the universe, who stands over all creation, who has no need to become anything else, comes to us and stands in the incarnation of his Son and says, not only will I be your King, not only will I be your God, not only am I your Creator, but I am the truest friend you can ever have. And my command to you is this: to love others as I love you. Father, I thank you so much for the God that you are, not who we think you are, not who we decide you to be, but for the God that you are and who we discover you to be. It is to you this morning that we lift our praises. It is to you who deserves the breath in our lungs that sings out to you. You're the one who deserves our attention. And Father, I stand with my friends and family here to confess that I give praise and I give attention to so many other things that are not worthy. And I allow who I am and my actions to be driven by other loves other than you. But this morning I confess that you are the King, that you are the truest friend. I have never experienced a love more than any greater than what you've shown me. There is no greater love than the friendship, the kingship, the lordship that you have revealed to all of us this morning. Father, as we come together in this time of praise and worship and offering, there isn't a part of our body, a part of our person, there isn't a part of us that doesn't think you deserve even more than what we bring this morning. Church, we're going to come into this time of offering, and I invite you to look upon the one to whom you're giving these things to. So many of us have business to do with God this morning. It's been a business that you have left on the long finger for a long time. But come to him now. And as you give your offering, as you give your offering of praise, an offering of time, do business with God so you can praise him.
Jesus, all for Jesus.
Father, there is so much that we still do not see that you have accomplished, so much that we do not see that you have done, so many things, Father, that we still do not see because our eyes are turned in other directions. But this morning, Father, again, we come together as your church, as your people, and we ask you for your patience, your mercy, and that you take the little that we can offer you today and help us to grow in faith and help us to grow in trust. Like our prayer through this song, that Father, take our hopes and our ambitions and make them all good for you. We have so much to learn, but Father, we thank you that you are our great teacher as much as you are everything else. And into your hands we just give this offering to you, knowing that it is so little and you give us so much, not in return, but you give us so much. You just give us so much. Praise be to you, Father. Praise be to the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Praise be to your Spirit. Amen. So again, we're going to do communion at the end of the service, just to let you know the flow. But before we do, I'm just going to ask Elder Tommy to come and preach the Word of God to us. And I invite you to take out your Bibles, take out anything you need to hear the Word of God preached this morning.
Morning, and of course to everyone online. Is it clear? Okay. I'm sure you all know what this sign is, right? Last time we did a road sign, well, kind of a road, not really a road sign, a drawing of traffic flow and so on. This one? Anyone? Cul-de-sac or no through road, dead end. Very simple, dead end. And, you know, I suppose many of us really only begin to turn around when we see the dead end. Like, so before that, remember last time we talked about three-point turns? You know, we said, like, you know, you realize you're on a motorway, highway, whatever it is, and you know you're going the wrong way. So you go, well, okay, so let's look for the next roundabout or crossroads where you can turn left, do a turn, and if you're in a lane, then you have to do a three-point turn. And I suppose that's a mini part of the whole series of Joseph, which is about God being the grandmaster, sovereign, and so on. And these three sermons, last one, I know 3 weeks ago, and then this one and next week, is all about how to really turn around, make a full, 180 degrees, 360 degrees, turn around. And it'd be simple for all of us if we just literally turned around. But many of us don't, and we do it in many maneuvers, 3 points at least, and so on, etc. That last time I said that, you know, Joseph's brothers, even though they're the ones who are apparently free and, you know, in Jacob's household, their father's household, and minding sheep and whatever it is in the land of Canaan, and had sold Joseph as a slave to Egypt, they actually were slaves as well. They were just chained by chains which you couldn't see. They were slaves because of their unconfessed sins. Years and years and years had passed, and they still let their father think that Joseph is dead. They haven't bothered to, you know, tell him that he could be alive. He wasn't actually killed by that animal, wild animal, and his coat was not actually dipped in his blood, in some other sheep's blood or something. And, you know, even as they faced famine and dire situation, they still remained in their unconfessed state. So they're paralyzed, helpless, hungry, and looking at each other blank. And then when they're asked about, you know, how is your family and so on, and they make excuses or they make more lies to cover up the first lies. Lies beget lies. You know, change without change. Lies beget lies. You have to cover up one lie with another lie. And then you know, literally their journey was just guilt all the way. Guilt trip, right? Self-inflicted. And that's only the beginning. Like, this is like a drawn-out process. If they just had the courage, if they just confessed, if they just said it, he'll resolve. I suppose we shouldn't judge Joseph's brothers. I'm like that. Sometimes I make mistake and I cover up one lie with another lie. I rationalize, I make excuses, I'm slow also to turn around. Hopefully, as I age, I'll be faster, and I hope you are as well. And here today, in this passage, in 43, we start to see a bit of a glimmer of hope. We start to see that there is some change in the brothers, maybe at least one of them, in the father a bit. This is, you know, the second, the first point's turn, second point's coming. We'll see that they are facing the second trip to Egypt because they've run out of food all over again. And they need to go back to the person who has said, you better bring your youngest brother here. And this is one of the signs of transformation or growth. A sign of growth in Christ or in God as a Christian is that you'll find that if this happened to you years ago, you would have done it that way. But now because it happened to you and you have grown by the grace of God and the Holy Spirit, you will do it differently. Or back then, you would have picked a certain decision, and now you're more sensitive to sin or to the Holy Spirit's leading. You allow Him to fill you more. It doesn't tempt you the same way. Years ago, you would have looked at women differently. Now you look at them differently. Money, shoes, whatever it is. Thank God that He's patient. Thank God He's patient. And, you know, we always still have our choices. And we can either choose to be aligned to God's will, or we can choose to go against God's will. We can either choose to be aligned to God's will, which often to us seems counterintuitive because it's contrary to our own sinful and self-centered nature and will. And if we only just allow and trust the leading and guidance of the Spirit, then we will find it easier to align to His will. So before I move on, let us pray. Let us really commit ourselves to listening to what God has to say to each one of us, including me, and how we can just hold on to the hope and grace that He has for us as He lovingly, patiently guides us in our second point of the turn. Father, Lord, even this is a story about Joseph and his brothers and his dysfunctional family and father and Potiphar's wife and so on. It really is a story about You, God. It's a story about how You are sovereign and in control. It is about You loving, guiding each of every one of us every step of the way. Even if we intend it for evil, even if we intend it because we're blasé, even if we're stubborn sometimes. But it is You who changes and transforms us. So let us learn today from the story of these lives how that transformation looks like. What does it take for us to be able to make and do the right thing? May these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in Your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So, we did chapter 42 last time. We do 43 this time, 44 next time. And we're going to read here, right? So, you know, again, a moderately long passage, but we'll just pick out the main key things. Verse 1. Now the famine was still severe in the land, because it was going to be 7 years, right? 7 years of abundance, 7 years of famine. And when they had eaten all the grain, not surprisingly, they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, remember the first time what they said? Why are you looking at each other? Staring at each other. Paralyzed and helpless. This time, go back and buy us a little more food. Now, actually, they already said they couldn't buy more food, and they repeat it to him again now. Now, mind you, Can you imagine a big household like Jacob's family where they have so much livestock and of course there's famine and so on, that there's no care or household stock taker of food and grain, and that when they first came back from Egypt the first time around there's like that much food in the barn or sacks anyway, and I don't know how long it lasts, but anyway, at the first stage it was maybe down to 75%, then to 50%, 25%, and did anyone tell them? Or do you actually go all the way until you've eaten all the grain? So you're actually now hungry because you don't have the next meal. Again, this is just delayed. They have to go all the way until they drive and see the dead end. Keep going until they have nothing, no more through road. And of course, the brothers explain why, and very quickly they say, because the man, the lord of the land, said we have to bring our youngest brother, and said you won't see me until you bring our youngest brother. And of course, the father says, why on earth did you tell them that you had a youngest brother? What's wrong with you? Okay, well, maybe that's just me saying. Okay, but he says this, right? They said, the man questioned us and just simply asked us, where are you from? Are you spies? Is your father living? Since you say you're from there, do you have a brother? Pretty innocent, they thought. And they said, he said, you need to bring your brother to me. You said you are not spies and you are honest men. Remember they said they're honest men, to be honest? Yeah. Well, they have eaten all the grain. Now what do they do? So, anyone know what happens next? I purposely didn't read the passage today, apart from that it's long. What happens next? How many brothers left? 10 plus one youngest one, Benjamin, do. What do the 10 brothers do? Well, they still haven't told the truth. They still haven't told the truth. I suppose they didn't know that was Joseph either. So they didn't know whether he was alive, but they certainly didn't tell the truth to the father. But as I say, there's a glimmer of hope here, right? Previously, they all blame each other. They're hiding each other. None of them have actually told their father the truth. They're all covering up for each other. Lies beget lies. Even though they sit through a guilt trip and face a dead end now. Well, finally, maybe out of desperation, Judah, now he's not the oldest son, right? So Reuben was the oldest son, but he slept with his father's wives. That's not good. Then Levi and Simeon are the next two sons, and they went on a rampage and cut off a lot of, zip. Anyway, so Judah becomes like the de facto older brother spiritually. And he also had his tragic moments, in chapter 38, he slept with his daughter-in-law. Yeah, the Bible is not pure. Here he says, look, we need to do something. I will take responsibility. I myself will guarantee his safety. You can hold me personally responsible for him, for his youngest brother. And if I do not bring him back and set him here before you, I will bear the blame before you all my life. Here is a man. A man willing to take responsibility and bear the blame. All you young girls there and also online looking for a man, make sure they're willing to take responsibility. He says, come on, let's go, right? If we had not delayed, we'd be back there and go there and come back twice. So the first sign of this proper turning around is courage. Courage to make the choice, the right thing. As someone shared to me yesterday, and I think it's very good and really fits here, sometimes we face problems, it's not about problem solving. It's just about courage to do the right thing. I totally agree. Judah, he was one of them as well, by the way. He said, let's get rid of this dreamer and so on. Okay, fine, he didn't say let him die and etc. But here now, he's responsible to start to, take charge. So, what happens next? What happens next? He said this. So the ball is now back in the father's court. Jacob, the deceiver. I mean, that's what his name actually means. Deceived his brother of his birthright. Went into a kind of a, stock trading with his uncle Laban for two wives, whom he then was also tricked into marrying the old one and so on. And we'll see here that Jacob, again, is not a perfect, decision or turnaround complete, but he's trying, he's doing, at least he's coming around, right? Because we'll see it. But before that, just a couple of other notes. Their father Israel, Jacob, said to them, "If it must be, then do this." All right? Okay, so look, if we have to do it, we better do this. Put some of the best products of the land in your bags and take them down to the man as a gift. A little balm and a little honey, some spices and myrrh, some pistachio nuts, yum, and almonds. Anyone, does that, any of that trigger a memory? What happened when Joseph was sold into Egypt? Who was he sold to? And what were the merchants carrying? That's right, spices and myrrh and so on. The Ishmaelites and Midianites, they were on the way to Egypt. They sold Joseph as a slave to them. They were carrying these things. Now the father tells them, "You bring these things down." Irony. More irony. Take the double the amount of silver. Remember, they sold Joseph for silver to buy grain. They went to bring money. They brought silver, came back to them, brought more silver, as if God was rejecting what they're doing. More irony. And that's a funny thing. You know, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I certainly can testify to this. Every time I do something wrong, every time I do something, and I think I initially get away with it, guess what? It comes right back to me. Every time I think I can get away with something, it will come back to me in a different shape and form with the same thing, reminding me exactly what I've done. Right. And again, it's because we just won't turn around earlier until we face the dead end. So, you know, Jacob is agreeing, right? Agreeing. He's agreeing to consider letting Benjamin go. But he wants to ensure his safety, bring them, spoil them by bringing back at least double the amount of silver, the myrrh and spice and all this good stuff of the land, whatever is left, and pistachio nuts and almonds, to ensure his safety. So, you know, he's still kind of not fully letting go, but he will let go. He will let go. And he goes, "Take your brother also and go back to the man at once." Fine, go, Joe, just go. "And may God Almighty grants you mercy before the man so that he will let your other brother and Benjamin come back with you. And as for me, if I am bereaved, I am bereaved." Right? So he's not like, you know, full of confidence and, you know, "Yes, no problem, I trust in God." You know, not quite there yet. That will have to wait. But he does do one thing amidst his struggles. He comes to terms with the fact that God is God. He comes to terms with the fact that God is almighty. Even though he can't see how it works, he can't see the outcome, he's still afraid of losing his son, Benjamin, he still will make other plans to make sure his to do the proper thing, so to speak, you know, which is not all incorrect. You know, but he says, with a little bit of faith and, if I'm bereaved, I'm bereaved. Now, this term, God Almighty, and, with songs about it, and El Shaddai, and so on, etc., it's very interesting here in this particular passage, in this juncture, because it's the fourth time it appears in the whole Bible, or in even Genesis, because obviously Genesis is the first book of the Bible. So when did it appear the other times? Well, the first time it appears is because when God talked to Abraham at the time, and said, "I am God Almighty, walk before me faithfully, and be blameless, then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." So, and by the way, blessings from God very often means lots of children. Doesn't necessarily have to mean lots of children, but just to say it that way, because you'll see this pattern again. But at that time, for Abraham, the start of the original family of God the Israelites, the Jewish family, the people of God. Well, having loads of children is important. So, I am God Almighty, El Shaddai, and I will greatly increase your numbers. Next occurrence, Genesis 28. This is Isaac saying to Jacob, even as he had to flee from his brother because he cheated his birthright by giving lentil soup and so on. Okay, God Almighty, bless you. May God Almighty, bless you and make you fruitful and increase your numbers again. And this time, until you become a community of people. So knowingly or unknowingly, Isaac said to Jacob, until God, you know, increase your numbers until you become a community of peoples. And the last time before this, is Jacob himself saying this to God. Oh, sorry, God saying to Jacob, I'm God Almighty, El Shaddai. He be fruitful and increase in number. And this time, it's not just a community of peoples. One family is not enough. You're going to be a community of nations. And kings will be among your descendants. I mean, this is the magnificence of God's blessing. This is crazy love, as Francis Chan puts it, Pastor Francis Chan. Crazy love, God's blessing upon his people. Well, one grandfather, then father, then son. He has assured them from well over a century ago, because they lived a modern, that they will be blessed. And they will have descendants, and they will have nations, and even kings. And here, you know, Jacob, with his 12 sons, and lost one, lost another one, Simeon, put in prison, risking losing another son. So you can partly feel, and he could possibly lose the other 9 sons. But he confesses that God had said who he is. You know, a bit of struggle, not like, you know, totally like, yeah, no problem. Bit of struggle, but he does confess this is God Almighty. And he will leave the outcome to God. So the second turn, or second point here, as you make this second point turn, I'm getting off now. First one, courage to make the right decision, to do the right thing. Second, by coming back and confessing, not only of your sins, but confessing who God is, just acknowledging he is God. I mean, if we say we trust God, and they're like, but God is just, I know, in some sense, God is a good friend, God is, you know, God is Lord, Jesus, Holy Spirit is God, I know. But one phrase, you know, really to sometimes just hone in is, God has all the goodness and power and glory, the majesty and the justice. God Almighty, El Shaddai. How big is your God? How awesome is he? And is he worth trusting? Do we really know God to be God Almighty? Do we really trust that God wants to bless us, even amidst our sticky situation? Okay, let's move on quickly. The story is very quick. You know, they travel down, they meet Joseph. I mean, there's no question about them meeting. It's just, you know, a matter of time. And, you know, the funny thing is this. You know, they go there, they bring the son, they bring the youngest son, the youngest brother, which is Benjamin, which is Joseph's own true brother of the same mother, as opposed to half-brothers of the other mothers, which is why it's so important. One reason. Second reason is because they also want to know, Joseph wanted to know what happened to Benjamin, because he was treated such a way. Maybe his brother was treated the same way. And since they brought him, well, okay, fine. The start of the resolution of the conflict, right? You start doing the right thing, you can start resolving the conflict. You can chat. In fact, you can eat. So, prepare a meal. And the man did as Joseph told him, took the men to Joseph's house. Now, of course, the men, the brothers, were frightened. They're like, what's going on? They thought, we were brought here because of the silver that was put back in our sacks the first time, and he wants to attack us and overpower us and seize us as slaves and take our donkeys. Right? They were the merchants who brought the myrrh and the spices, who got money for the silver, and now it's all just happening to them, they think. We are now going to be slaves because we had been bad boys when we were young. So they went to Joseph's steward. I mean, quickly they tried to, you know, negotiate or to explain away, and they said, I beg your pardon. We beg your pardon. We came down here the first time to buy food, but at the place where we stopped the first night, for the night, we opened our sacks, and each of us found his silver, the exact weight in the mouth of his sack. So we have brought it back with us. Now, does it ever occur to anyone here that the first time when we read it, if you had just left Egypt and brought your food, and then you stop for the first night, and you realize the silver's back, it didn't seem to occur to anyone, maybe even to us as readers, why didn't they go back and just return the silver? No, they carried it quite happily home. Honesty? So now they quickly explain everything and say, yes, we actually found the silver. Yeah, so we are now bringing it back. By the way, only bring it back because we actually ran out of grain and food, and we're now coming back to buy more food. So yeah, we did bring the original silver, now the new silver. And we don't know who put the silver there, and so on, etc. So what happens next? So this comes to towards the end of this part, right? So we are courageous. We start to do the right thing, right? We confess that God is God, and yes, we should just go with him. But do you sense that fear? Do you sense that thing that nags on your conscience? That you know is not right still, because it's not there yet, right? There's still like unexplained things about, well, what happened to their brother? You know, what will happen to Benjamin? It's not quite there yet. And you can sense that, you know, we are still honest men, and we've even brought back this first silver, and you know, look at the good stuff we brought from Canaan, and we brought the youngest brother. And you know, they don't even need to be told; they know it themselves. It's the same for us. When we have done something wrong, unless your conscience is so flat, you know, we know if we've done something wrong, and we are afraid. And this is the goodness, the grace, the mercy of God. The goodness, the grace, and the mercy of God is, he tells us it's going to be okay. Keep trusting me. I'm here. Don't be afraid. The God of your father has given you treasure in your sacks. I've received your silver. I know you're bringing the silver back. I've got it. And I even bring back out your brother. And they proceed on to prepare the meal. Okay, we quickly move on. The steward took men into Joseph's home, gave them water to wash their feet, and provided fodder for their donkeys, which is proper hospitality. So if you've traveled down the desert road and so on, your feet need to be washed, your donkeys are hungry, they need fodder. They prepared their gifts for Joseph's arrival at noon because they had heard they would eat there. So they are still being treated well. When Joseph came home, they presented him the gifts they brought into the house, and they bowed down before him to the ground. The dreams coming true again. He asked them how they were, and then he said, how is your father, aged father, that you told me about? Is he still living? Your servant, our father, is still alive and well. And they bowed down, prostrating themselves before him. And as he looked about and saw his brother, and now you have to switch modes, right? So don't read it from a third person. Like, switch modes. Think about Joseph. So now read as if you were Joseph, right? Before you. You see Benjamin, your own mother's son, your very brother. And it was, 13 years ago. He was probably very young, maybe 6, now maybe 19, maybe, approximately. Is this your youngest brother, the one you told me about? God be gracious to you, my son. Deeply moved at the sight of his brother, Joseph hurried and looked for a place to weep. He went into his private room and wept there. It tells you that Joseph is not angry. And sometimes we read this, read the Bible, and we get mistaken in things. Like, for example, like when he pulled his trick about putting the silver back in there, or when he accused them of spies, we thought that is because Joseph is harsh and angry and taking revenge. It's not true. That might be the way we think, or I would think. No, if you read the whole thing, the whole context, you'll realize, no, Joseph was actually just trying to find out the truth about this, about Benjamin, whether he was really true or lie, about the brothers, whether they have harmed him and did the same thing to him as they did to Joseph and to Benjamin. He wants to see whether they've truly repented and changed. This is what this is about. And as you can see, here, even at this juncture, he wept. After he had washed his face, he came out, served the food. They served him by himself, the brothers by themselves, the Egyptians by themselves, because the Egyptians could not eat with Hebrews, for that is detestable to Egyptians. And here is the second last most shocking thing. Right, there are two more, but this is the second last most shocking thing of the brothers' experience. The men had been seated before him in the order of their ages, from the firstborn to the youngest. And they looked at each other in astonishment, like nothing makes sense. We were accused of being spies. We were sent home, and our silver was in a sack. We've now come, and now we're being invited to this, you know, the lord of the land's house. I mean, remember, this guy was basically prime minister. They're eating with him, you know, albeit separately and so on. And they're seated in order. Who told them that's exactly how, who, you know? They looked at each other in astonishment. The third thing that happens, as we really true to make that, you know, finish off that second point turn. Courage is the first one, to do the right thing, to make the right decision. Say or do the right thing. Second one being, you confess that because it's God is who's in control, he's almighty. And even as we feel the fear or the consequences or the, you know, like because it's not quite fully there because you haven't fully come clean and so on, etc., you'll be surprised. You'll be surprised. You can relax. God is good. God does love you. Yeah, I know he punishes as well, his wrath and so on, and I'm not going to belittle that. But really, as you come and draw close to him, he will take you. He will look after you. Do we feel that God is not a good God after all, and that's why we have such fear? Have we tasted and known his goodness? If we have, this shouldn't be a surprise. This won't come as a curveball. If we have made a full repentance, you can expect his peace, his shalom, completeness, his mercy, his grace. If really you have made a full repentance, in due course, if not quite immediately, in due course, God will make it clear that you've done the right thing. God will acknowledge you because you have acknowledged him. And you can be pleasantly surprised by the blessings. The brothers think the worst of their fate. Oh, we're going to be attacked, made into slaves, etc. You know, we're going to be subdued, you know. And yet, God says, I want to give you peace, shalom. The peace that they did not grant Joseph many years ago, God grants Joseph's brothers. He is gracious. He is merciful. And it's all because God is a God who, whilst he's just, is also full of grace and mercy. Whilst we should have borne the consequences of our sins and our actions and inactions, either one, which might be wrong, so either our wrong actions or sometimes the wrong inactions, and we live in that fear, as we come to Jesus, as we come to God, we know that he will receive us. The penalty of death that we should have borne, he has taken away on the cross. he has taken away on the cross. Jesus himself was full of courage, and he stood up to the religious leaders and hypocrites, legalists, Pharisees then at the time. He knew whatever he went through, whether it's temptations at the beginning of ministry, whether it's baptism, whether it's betrayal by his friends and disciples, always knew that God was with him, even in the Garden of Gethsemane, even at the cross where he said, "Father, Lord, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And to all of us, our surprise that he didn't stay dead, he came back alive again. The story doesn't quite end there, and we have a communion. The very last verse is set up for next week's chapter sermon. When the portions were served, Benjamin's portion was 5 times as much as anyone else's. That's the biggest surprise. Save the best for last. And they started to feast and drink freely with him. You know, the release is that they finally feel a bit more ease, even though they're like, "What's going on here?" But anyway, think about it later. Let's eat. I'm hungry. Right? So we leave that for next week. But for us today, can we come to God with the courage when we know we've done the wrong thing, but to start to make amends by doing the right thing? It takes courage. Right? As I said, not problem solving, it's courage. Are we willing to confess? We all know God. Right? Everyone here, right, knows God. Everyone, you know God. I want to invite you to really, really know God as God Almighty. Trusting in his goodness. And then you don't need to be in fear and surprised and shocked and so on, but you can just expect his goodness to follow. Let us pray, and then we also come before the communion table. Father, Lord, we just want to give you thanks that you are amazing. Even as we, as you know, frail and futile as we are, and very often going around in circles and approaching dead ends and whatnot, you know, making one mistake after another, or worse still, making the one mistake and then making the mistake worse by refusing to turn around, and then living in the state that we are, where we're not free, where we have that guilt, where we have this thing shadowing and overburdening us. You know, whether it's a simple lie or a complicated one, whether it's, you know, anger that's harbored, whether it's falling out with someone, whether it's, you know, deception in business or work or in college, whatever it is, do we trust God? Do we really trust God? I mean, if we say we're Christians, who are we trusting? And who is this God? Is he the El Shaddai, God Almighty? The I Am is who I am. Who is in charge of our lives? Not to go against us, but because he just loves us in this. And who's proven that love on the cross, taking away all the penalty of our sin. Just come before him and confess. Remember his body broken for us, his blood shed for us, so that we may be made whole again, and that our sins can be forgiven, and we can have eternal life. Let's remember.
To make me
I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So brothers and sisters, for those who are Christians who have been baptized, I invite you to take, whether online, at home, or here, a bread and cup to remember what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us, shedding his blood for us, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for us to have eternal life. Let's take the bread and cup together. Stand to receive the blessing of the Lord. God is good. He's an almighty God. El Shaddai deserves our worship, our trust, and praise. Come to him boldly, courageously. Come and confess the sins and confess that he is the Lord. And just wait for it. Wait for it. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of Father God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every single one of us here today and at home forever and ever. Amen. Amen.